What's up guys, Julian Goldie here and welcome to today's video. In this video, we're going to take a look at how to build a website for SEO in 2022. And the main aim of this video is to help you figure out how you can build and basically set up a new website so that it will perform well when it comes to SEO. Now, a lot of people that are new to SEO just think you can throw up any old site and then get great results with Google. I mean, if only it were that easy, right? I wouldn't have to make this video and you could probably be watching something on Netflix, but sadly, if you want to get amazing results with SEO, you need to make sure you can build up your site the right way. And that basically means that you need to focus on ticking off a few key boxes when it comes to building your site. And some of these things are kind of obvious, but a few of them, such as the tips in section number 3, might only make sense once you have a little bit of experience when it comes to SEO. Anyway, you can't really drop the ball on anything we're going to mention in this video, as most of the things here are of equal importance. I mean, if you ignore one of these things, you're going to be limiting your ability to succeed with SEO, and in a world where you already have to deal with tough SEO competition, why make things harder on yourself, right? So make sure you watch to the end, or else you probably won't have a good overview of all the things you need to do, and that could obviously hurt your ability to succeed with SEO. Okay, so with that said, let's get started and dive straight in. So section number 1 is about picking a domain. So the first thing we're going to be touching on here is how to choose your URL. Now, there's a lot of different opinions in the SEO community when it comes to picking a domain, and to be honest, you don't really want to overcomplicate things here. A lot of people think that if you pick an exact match domain, you will achieve much better rankings. If you don't know what that is, an exact match domain is basically a domain that resembles a really valuable target keyword. So if you're selling fishing supplies, an exact match domain might be something like buyfishingsupplies.com. The thinking here is that this domain signals relevance and this then helps you get better rankings on Google. And to be fair, there's some evidence this worked really well in the early days of SEO. But when it comes to modern times, well, it doesn't really look like this approach works anymore. Now, if you're an experienced SEO person with a different take here, you might want to challenge me on that. And of course, if you have some opinions on this, let me know in the comment section. But generally, many people in the SEO community feel that a better approach nowadays is to go for a branded domain. So this is basically a domain that represents your brand and it doesn't really need to have any relevance to the stuff that's on your site. For example, if we take the fishing supplies example from earlier, a branded domain here could be something completely random like redplasticbottle.com. Now that's a bit of a random example, but hopefully it illustrates the point I'm trying to make here. And I should mention that one of the reasons branded domains work is because Google is really trying to identify and then push websites associated with brands. This is one of the ways they can tell spammy sites apart from genuine websites that represent real businesses and credible sources of information. So, if you focus on picking a branded domain over an exact match domain that looks as though it's trying to game the system, you'll find that it's probably easier to get good rankings on Google. Now, at this point, you might be wondering if it's a good idea to go with a .com domain or a domain that represents a certain country. Generally, I'd say it's better to go with a .com domain. This is because you have a lot more freedom with a .com website. If you pick a domain associated with a certain country, you can still achieve rankings in other countries, but it can be a little bit more difficult. After all, Google wants to provide people with relevant results. And if your website is associated with a country that's different from the country of the person performing the search, you could argue that's not that relevant. In fact, it's not just me saying this. This is actually what Google is saying themselves. Now, with a .com domain, you don't really have this issue. Plus, as mentioned in the graphic shown earlier, if you pick a .com domain, you can actually go into the Google Search Console and tell Google that you want to target a certain region. This can then help you narrow down your audience if you're trying to focus on a particular country. Of course, if you change your mind later on, you can just tell Google that you no longer want to focus on a specific country, and this will then help you reach a much broader audience. By the way, I just want to say, if you can, please take a second to like this video and become a subscriber. If you like my videos, I can reach more people, and if you become a subscriber, it's going to be much easier for you to find my future videos, and that's really going to improve your general experience when it comes to YouTube. I mean, don't you want to see my face every time you log into YouTube, right? Anyway, section number 2 is about picking a hosting provider. Once you've picked a domain, You then need to think about picking a hosting provider. Now, there's many different hosting providers to choose from. And again, this isn't really something you want to overcomplicate, especially if you're just starting with a small project. That said, if your website is going to focus on a specific region, you might want to go with a hosting provider that lets you pick where your hosting servers are going to be located. There's some evidence that this can help your audience experience faster website speeds, and it might also help signal to Google that your website is associated with a particular region. This can then help you rank better, especially if your domain is a plain.com domain that isn't associated with a certain region. Next up, you have to make sure your domain has SSL. Once you've picked a domain and a hosting provider, you also want to make sure your domain makes use of SSL. We won't go into this massively here, but SSL essentially means that your website provides users with a HTTPS secure connection. So, to simplify, if you want a secure HTTPS connection, you're going to need an SSL certificate. Now, Google really values this, and they tend to penalize websites that don't make sure of this. In fact, here's an official blog post from 2014 where they talk about HTTPS being a ranking signal on Google. Luckily, setting up SSL is kind of easy, as you just need to buy an SSL certificate from your hosting provider, and these aren't expensive. But if you're on a budget, keep in mind that some hosting providers provide free SSL certificates, so you don't need to pay for them. You might want to keep this in mind if you're on a budget, because to be honest, an SSL certificate is kind of non-negotiable at this point. Section number four, you have to pick a content management system. Now, once you've done all of the things I've mentioned previously, you then need to basically build out your site. Now, when it comes to SEO, I think the best approach here is to pick a simple content management system like WordPress. This is basically because WordPress makes things a lot easier when it comes to optimizing your site for SEO. Plus, WordPress is really easy to use and customize, and this is really helpful if you lack technical skills when it comes to coding and things like that. Personally, I don't enjoy it, and that's why I use WordPress. Now, if you don't know how to install WordPress, just contact your hosting provider, and they should be able to help you with this in under 24 hours. Next up, you have to pick a theme for your WordPress site. Now, once you've installed WordPress, you then need to focus on picking a damn good theme. So what counts as a good theme? Well, it needs to look good. It needs to be easy to use, aka it needs to provide a good experience, and it needs to load quickly. Plus, it should be mobile friendly. And if you're on a budget, you might just want to go with a free theme that is relatively simple and easy on the eye. Or if you're happy to spend a little bit of moolah on a theme, but not a lot, you might want to check out Theme Forest. I've included a link to this site in the description, but this site is basically just a marketplace for WordPress themes. If you check it out, you should end up finding something that looks good, performs well, and is actually within your budget. By the way, if you have a favorite theme you swear by, mention it in the comment section. I'd love to check it out. Number six, it's time to start installing plugins. So once you've installed WordPress and you've picked a theme, you then want to install some plugins so that you can optimize the SEO side of your site. Of course, there's tons of SEO plugins to choose from, and you're free to check them all out if you want to. That said, there are some things that you'll really want to pay careful, close attention to. By the way, if you want to check out these plugins, there's links to them in the description of this video. But one really important plugin you might want to use is called Yoast SEO. This is a SEO plugin that helps you optimize your content, web pages, and just your overall site so you can achieve better rankings. Plus, it's really easy to use, and there's a lot of documentation on this plugin, which makes it easy to troubleshoot issues. You might also want to install the Sitekit plugin from Google, and if you want to track your SEO results, you'll need to use some tools from Google, such as Analytics, Search Console, which is actually something we're going to mention later on. Anyway, if you use these tools, you'll need to install some code on your site. And if you install this plugin, it becomes really easy to install this code. Because of this, the plugin is definitely a must-have, because it will save you a ton of time. Another plugin you might want to pay close attention to is the Smush plugin. It has a funny name, but this is a plugin that will compress the images on your site. And this is so helpful because it will help you speed up the loading times on your site, which is really important if you want to achieve good rankings. There's a ton of other plugins you can experiment with here, and it's pretty much endless. And you know, honestly, each SEO person tends to have their own favorite collection. If you've got some favorite plugins, let me know in the comment section. I'd love to know about your favorites too. Either way, you should be able to get some good mileage from the ones I've mentioned here, so I wouldn't worry about adding loads more. Plus, if you add too many, it can slow down your WordPress site, and this is bad for the user experience side of things. Section number seven it's time to set up tools, right? So the next thing you want to do is actually set up some important tools outside of your website. This step is super important if you want to gather helpful data that will help you optimize your approach to SEO. Now, for the most part, you really just want to focus on Google Analytics and Google Search Console here. Now, Google Analytics will help you track the visitors to your site, as well as how people are generally interacting and using your site. For example, you can see the pages that are attracting the most traffic, and you can also see bounce rates. Now, this tool also helps you see where your traffic is coming from in terms of actual geographical locations, but also in terms of online traffic sources too. So it'll tell you if your visitors are coming from Facebook or an email newsletter, and basically stuff like that. Now, Google Search Console will provide you with data in terms of how people are interacting with your site in the Google search listings. For example, if you use this tool, it will tell you about all the kinds of keywords that lead to your website appearing on Google search. So yeah, one's kind of focused on just general website traffic, and the other is focused more on the SEO side of things. If you want to use these tools, you'll need to actually verify that you own the site you're looking to track with them. Luckily, if you installed the Sitekit plugin we mentioned earlier, this isn't that hard to do. By the way, again, I just want to say that there are links to all of these tools in the description of this video. Section number 8, it's time to start submitting sitemaps. At this point, you want to submit your sitemaps to Google. Now, sitemaps basically give Google a good overview of your website, and they can help Google figure out what your website is about, all of which can help you rank better. There are basically two steps you need to focus on here. So first off, you need to create a sitemap. If you're using the Yoast SEO plugin, you should be able to create a sitemap pretty easily. That's because there's actually a section in Yoast dedicated to this. Now, if you create a sitemap using Yoast, it will then provide you with a URL for the sitemap. Once you create your sitemap, you actually then need to submit it. Now, if you want to do this, you then need to go into the sitemap section of Google Search Console and provide the URL associated with your sitemap. Once you've done this, you should then see a message telling you if the submission was a success. Now it's time to optimize URLs and page structure. So the next step here is just to make sure your pages and URLs are optimized. It's important to optimize URLs because Google can often work out what a certain page is about by looking at the content of a URL. So if you stick with the default WordPress settings, your URLs are just gonna look like random collections of words and numbers. Of course, this can hurt your rankings because Google can't understand what your URLs are about. Because of this, you should change things so that your URLs actually represent the content of a web page. Luckily, you can adjust the URL structure of your site by going into the permalink settings section. And you can find this section in the left-hand sidebar in WordPress. Anyway, if you go to this section, you can see that WordPress basically offers you a number of different options when it comes to URLs. In most cases, the post name option is the best one to go for. If you're feeling brave, you can use the custom structure option, but you need to make sure you know what you're doing here. Note that you don't want to over-optimize your URLs and basically make things worse than the default setting. Another thing I just want to touch on here is that you want to make sure you take a lot of care when it comes to page structure. So you want to make sure you're using the right H1 and H2 tags when creating your content. Again, this will help Google figure out what certain web pages are about, and this can also give Google a sense of what your website is just generally about as well, all of which is going to help you rank better for keywords that are related to your niche. Section number 10, testing your site and in-person feedback. So lastly, you might just want to get people to use your site so that you can get some feedback from them. This is really helpful. And other people might pick up on certain user experience or design issues that you totally missed. Now, there are websites that offer this as a service, but most of the time, you can just get the opinion of a friend if you just buy them a few drinks next time you're out, and I'm sure they won't mind helping you out with this. By the way, if you're worried you might have dropped the ball on something here, you might want to book in a free consultation with me at juliangoldie.com. While I tend to specialize in link building, I often have to review client websites to make sure they cover some of the basic things mentioned in this video. After all, if they didn't, any of the links I built might not actually work as well. So if you'd like a second opinion, consider booking a free consultation call. And if you do this, we could even discuss how you can build backlinks to your site as well. Okay, so that's the end of this video. Hopefully you now have a decent sense of how you should set up and build your site for SEO. Aside from the domain, it's important to remember that you can pretty much adjust everything we've mentioned here at any point in time. So basically, that means you don't have to do everything we've covered all in the space of one day. That might be a little bit too much. Of course, you definitely still need to make sure you do the stuff we've mentioned, but if you want to do things gradually over the course of a month or two, step by step, slowly, that's perfectly fine. Anyhow, thanks for watching this video and please remember to like and subscribe. If you like my video, I'd really appreciate it. And for every subscriber I get, I'm going to give away one free link. Okay, not really. But if you become a subscriber, I will release more videos on how to get backlinks. And in some ways, that's basically the same, right? So thanks for watching and see you guys next time.